Today I'll discuss a very well-designed randomized controlled trial on overactive bladder syndrome in men. And the randomized controlled trial is about the best treatment sequence. Welcome back to Pelvic News Channel, the channel for physiotherapists with an interest in the pelvic region. So if you like this channel, please give it a thumbs up and of course subscribe to my channel and hit the notification bell so if I upload future videos, you'll get a notification straight away. The objective of this trial was to see whether combining behavioral therapy with drug therapy had a better result than drug therapy or behavioral therapy alone. Overactive bladder syndrome is defined by the International Continence Society as urinary urgency combined with urinary frequency nocturia and with or without urinary incontinence. Behavioral therapy can consist of pelvic floor muscle training or bladder training. And drug therapy, well, there are different types of drugs, but in this trial they used the alpha blockers, which have an influence on the smooth muscle tone of the bladder outlet. And they use the antimuscarinics, which have an influence on the contraction of the bladder. For this trial, they had three groups. One group who got 12 weeks of a combination of behavioral and drug therapy. Group 2 who had 6 weeks of behavioral therapy stepped up with drug therapy after 6 weeks. And group 3 is the group who started with drug therapy and who were stepped up after 6 weeks with behavioral therapy. Men of 40 years and older were included, and they had to have 9 voids or more per 24 hours. And there were quite a lot of exclusion criteria, and if you want to know the full list, you can read it in the full text article. But for instance, urinary tract infection, prostate cancer were exclusion criteria. And to ensure equal groups, they divided the men in two groups, men with 9 to 12 voids per 24 hours and a group with men who had over 12 voids per 24 hours. And within these groups, there was a difference between men who were incontinent and who weren't incontinent. And in this trial, they used toltrodine as an antimuscarinic drug and tamsulosine as an alpha blocker. And for the behavioral therapy, all men had an anal examination. And in this examination, they examined a proper contraction, but also how well the contraction was performed. And the training schedule was based on the examination. And in total, the men had to contract for 10 seconds, 15 times, 3 times a day. So in total, they had to do 45 contractions a day. And the bladder training consisted of, for instance, urge suppression techniques, but also the advice to stop drinking 3 hours before the men went to bed. And this is to see what the influence was on nocturia. The measurements used in this trial were a voiding diary. And the voiding diary was asked at baseline, 6 weeks and 12 weeks. And the overactive bladder questionnaire, the International Prostate Symptom Score, and there were several questions on patient satisfaction and the adherence to drug and behavioral therapy. The primary outcome measure was the voiding frequency, and the secondary outcomes were the urgency, nocturia, and incontinence. In total, 204 men were included in the intention to treat analysis, and 183 men completed the whole program. And in the behavioral therapy group, there were 71 men and there were 8 dropouts, and the mean age was 63.3 years. In the drug therapy alone group, there were 68 men with 7 dropouts with a mean age of 65.5, and in the combined therapy There were 65 men with 6 drops out and with a mean age of 63.2. The best results were at 6 weeks the combined therapy. However, there was not a significant difference between the combined therapy and the behavioral therapy. And at 12 weeks, there was no difference or no significant difference between the three groups. In this graph, you can see the differences at the different measurement times. And you can see that the main difference is at 6 weeks. And the behavioral therapy and the combined therapy made really changed, and the drug therapy change less. And if we have a look at the percentage of change, this shows it even better. And you can see that behavioral therapy and the combined therapy had a change of 24.7 and 30.5, and the drug therapy only of 12.7%. And at 12 weeks, well, these differences were not significant anymore. And if we have a look at the secondary outcome measures, we start with nocturia. And there was a significant decrease in all three groups. But the combination therapy had the best results. The mean urgency scores were significantly improved in the combination therapy. And there was no significant decrease in the drug therapy or the behavioral therapy alone group. Regarding the incontinence, there was a significant decrease in all three groups as well, but in this outcome measure, the combination therapy was superior as well. And they had an improvement of 81.6%. So at baseline, there was a urinary incontinence at 6.6 times per week, and at 12 weeks, this was decreased until 1.2 incontinence episodes per week. The outcome of the overactive bladder questionnaire in the International Prostate Symptom Score was significant for all groups, but the combination therapy had the best results. And the patient perception of improvement, if we have a look at the much better and the better group, they were grouped, there was no difference between the three groups. And the question regarding the satisfaction of the patients at 12 weeks had the same outcome. There was no difference in satisfaction between the three groups. And the last outcome I want to discuss is the bothersomeness of adverse events. And for this, there was a combination of no adverse events and not at all bothersome. And at 6 weeks, the behavioral therapy group, 86%, had no, scored no. And the drug therapy, this was 32%, and in the combined therapy, 34%. At 12 weeks, the behavioral therapy group, so they started with behavioral therapy and then stepped up with drug therapy, 48% reported no adverse events or not at all bothersome. Drug therapy, 35%, so started with drugs combined with behavioral therapy. And in the combined therapy, this was 37%. And this trial shows that the combination therapy had the best results. However, there were no significant differences between the combination therapy and the behavioral therapy group. And therefore, the authors advise to start the therapy with behavioral therapy. And if there is not enough improvement after 6 weeks, the patient can discuss with their physician whether they want to add drugs to their therapy. And this is a very well designed randomized controlled trial. And I think for us pelvic physiotherapists, this is very interesting because we can discuss these outcomes with our referring physicians, but also with our patients when they ask us questions about drug therapy. I often get this question, isn't there a pill for my problem? And in the original article, there's a lot more information and numbers. So if you want to know all the ins and outs, please have a look at the full manuscript. And I put a link, all the details down below. So I hope you liked this video, and please give it a thumbs up if you like it. Subscribe, share this channel with your colleagues, because maybe they are not aware of it. See you next time. Bye bye.